A very good afternoon to all dear participants. This is Mr. Rahul Patil, presently working as a student professor in the Department of Zoology at Rare Shikshan Sansthas Balwant College, Vita. At the very outset, I would like to thank Dr. Humne sir and his team for organizing this 5 days online national workshop on CSIR, UGC, NET GRF and LS preparation in life sciences. Dear friends, it is a golden opportunity for all NET SET aspirant. I congratulate all the members of the Botany for You for organizing this wonderful activity in this COVID-19 pandemic. Dear friends, in this workshop, we are going to discuss on the journey of DNA to the proteins. It is not possible for me to cover the all aspects of this topic within a 30 to 35 minutes. So dear friends, I have prepared a different parts of this lecture. So today we are going to discuss a very first part of this topic, which is on the DNA replication, and remaining part will be discussed in upcoming lecture series. Dear friends, as we all aware that the living cells and organisms are characterized by their remarkable activity to reproduce and transmit characteristics generation after generation and maintain the continuity of inherited traits. For this function, they have need to duplicate their genome. And to duplicate that genome, we require the DNA replication. And that's why we have chosen the first part of the journey as the DNA replication. Dear friends, today we are going to discuss about the history of DNA. Then we discuss about the different raw material required for the DNA replication. We will discuss about the different modes of the DNA replication. And we will also discuss the different enzymes which play a crucial role in the DNA replication. And lastly, we discuss about the different mechanism of replication in eukaryotes, like initiation, elongation, and termination. Dear friends, as we know that, the history of nucleic acid. In 1869, the Frederick Miescher worked on the pulse cell and he found that a black spot under the microscope in the pulse cell and gives a name as the nuclei. Dear friends, the pulse cell having a black spot and the name that given by the Frederick Miescher is the nuclei. Dear friends, after 20 years, the Richard and Altman studied the properties of that nuclein and he found out that particular nuclein has the acidic properties and he gives the name as nuclein as the nucleic acid. Dear friends, now the world knows that the nucleic acid has acidic properties. So after that, what happened? The many of the scientists from the every corner of the world are working on this nucleic acid to find out what is the structure of the nucleic acid, what is the function of that nucleic acid. And the first experiment was carried out in 1920 by the Griffith. He found that he worked on the rat and the particular to the pneumococcus bacteria, streptococcus pneumonis bacteria, and he found that there is something which is present in the cells which transfer from a cell to another cells, and he gives the name to that experiment as the theory of transformation. And dear friends, in 1944, Avery and his colleagues showed that DNA was the key component of Griffith experiments in which the mice are injected with the dead bacteria of one strain and live bacteria of another and develop an infection of the dead strain type. So Avery proves that the experiment of the Griffith was the material which transferred from the cell is nothing but the DNA or the genetic material. So the discovery of DNA is the in the 20th century is one of the landmark discovery in biology. So after the discovery of DNA as the genetic material, many of the scientists are working on to find out the structure of the DNA. And the first attempt was carried out by the Rosalind Franklin and his colleague Wilkin in 1955, and he is successful to give the photo 51 the crystallography structure of DNA. And as we are aware about the history of Franklin, what happened with her, what happened with his with her research. Dear friends, on the basis of the study of the Rosalind Franklin and Wilkins, the Francis Crick and Watson carried out the study on the structure of DNA and discovered the double helical structure of DNA and stated that the DNA is double helical and having the two anti-parallel strands bind each other by the hydrogen bond. So this is the another landmark discovery of the structure of the DNA. After that, what happened? The many of the scientists are working on the functions of the DNA and what are the role of the DNA in the life of the cells. Dear friends, after that, many of the scientists have discovered the different types of the proteins. I mentioned here in 1955, the main proteins required for the DNA replication was discovered by the Earthen Kornberg, and the study is go on. Dear friends, nowadays we are facing or we are fighting to COVID-19 pandemic. And we know that the scientists from the every corner of world are going to produce the vaccines. And as we know that the production of the vaccines, we need to detailed study of the nucleic acid material present in that particular vaccine, particular viruses. As we know that the COVID-19 is having the RNA as the nucleic acid. So, dear friends, nowadays the research is also is going on the nucleic acid. So, dear friends, for the normal function of the cells, it requires to produce the different types of the proteins. So, it requires to synthesize the different types of the proteins. And as we know that for the protein synthesis, they are dependent on the DNA. But, dear friends, how the cells is decode the proteins, decode the DNA, or how to crack the code present in the DNA to produce the protein synthesis or to synthesize the different types of the proteins. What are the exactly procedure to synthesize the proteins from the DNA? So all such type of the question, answer of the such all type of the questions are lies on the central dogma of life or the central dogma of protein synthesis. Here I mentioned the modern central dogma of protein synthesis or the life, because as we know that the DNA is the magic molecule of every cells and which has ability to convert its another form or converts into the a duplicate form that called by the process that called as the replication. Dear friends, DNA has a basic language in the ATGC form. So DNA is made from the nucleotides, phosphate and the sugar, and the language of the DNA is in the codon, that is adenine, thymine, guanine and cytosine. Dear friends, what happened that during the transformation or during the decoding of that particular DNA language, the language is transcribed into the RNA language. So what happened here, the thymine is just modified in the RNA as the uracil. So this by the process of the transcription. So by the process of transcription, DNA is converted into the RNA molecules. So this is about the old concept. But dear friends, after the discovery of the viruses, the world knows that the RNA can be converted into the DNA by the reverse process of transcription, that is the reverse transcription by using the enzyme reverse transcriptase. This study was firstly carried out by the Tamin, and hence it is also called as the Taminism. So the reverse transcription is also called as the Taminism, because the first study on this reverse transcription was carried out by the Tamin. Dear friends, as we know that after the decoding of RNA language, the RNA is translated into the protein language. So RNA is converted into a protein by the process of translation. And as we know that well discoveries in the protein, the scientists are successfully convert this protein by decoding itself into the RNAs. So now we are easy to convert the proteins. When we got the protein in that particular cell, we can identify the genome of that particular proteins by decoding itself. So dear friends, as we know that when we go for the genomic library or the cDNA library, we construct the DNA from the mRNA. So as we know that we can also construct the DNA from the RNA that in the construction of the cDNA library by just decoding the DNA. Dear friends, this is about the central dogma of life, which plays in every cells, every living cells, every living organisms. So dear friends, as we know that the when we go for any process, we require some sort of the raw material. So when we talk about the DNA replication, we also require the raw materials. The first raw material is NTP. So NTP is nothing but nitrogen phosphate, nucleotide phosphate. So these are used for the addition of the primer, and as we know that the primer is in the RNA. So ATP, GTP, CTP, TTP, UTP are as added as the primer. Then we require the deoxyribonucleotide phosphates, that is the DATP, DCTP, DTTP and DGTP for the polymerization of the DNA. And we require the energy in the form of ATP. And last, we require the cofactors like the Mg2+ for the various enzymatic reactions. So dear friends, these are the some raw factors required for when we go for the DNA replication. Dear friends, as we know that you have a question in your mind, you are going to synthesis in the DNA, and why we are adding the primer as the RNA. The question of this answer, the answer of this question we will discuss in upcoming lecture, upcoming slides. Then we discuss about the different modes of the replication. Primitively, there are three different types of the modes of the DNA replication, that is conservative, non-conservative and a semi-conservative mode of the DNA replication. But according to the Michelson and Stahl, they carried out the experiment and stated that the DNA replication is always takes place in most of the cell, that is the semi-conservative mechanism. So dear friends, what is the conservative mechanism and what are the semi-conservative mechanism and the non-conservative mechanism? Dear friends, what happened in the semi-conservative mechanism? Here we see that in this model, the two strands of the DNA unwind from each other and each act as the template. Here we see that there are two strands. They are formed by the heavy isotope of nitrogen. We stated that the HH, which act as the template strand. And this results into two DNA molecules with one original strand and one or the another is the new strand. Here we see that the new strand, that is L, that is low isotope of nitrogen, and one is the old strand. So that means we found that this phenomenon as the semi-conservative mechanism of DNA replication. So what happened in the conservative mode of replication? In this model, the DNA replication result in one molecules that consist of both original DNA strands. Here we see that the parents has the H strands and the progeny having the both H strands. Here we see that both LL strands. So that means in this model, it consists of both original DNA strands, which is identical to the original DNA molecules, and another molecules that consist of the two new strands. That means here we got the two different new strands, which is not the mixture of the old and new strand. But when we talk about the non-conservative mode, what happened, or the dispersive replication? In this dispersive model, DNA replication result in two DNA molecules that are the mixture or the hybrid of parental and daughter DNA. In this model, each individual strand is a patchwork of original and new DNA strand. So this is about the modes of the DNA replication. By the Michelson and Stahl experiment, they proved that the DNA replication is the semi-conservative mechanism. How they carried out the function, how they carried out the experiment, here I'm not going to discuss the detail because we have only short time. So we are just switching to another point. So this type of the questions may be asked in the CSIR net question in the C section for the 4 marks. Then we discuss about the important points which is asked directly for the 2 marks. The replication is the bidirectional process. As we know that the replication When the helicase unwind that particular DNA, the replication fork or the replication bubble was formed, and the replication is started at the two points from the two points, that is 3 prime to 5 prime, from the 5 prime to 3 prime stands, and the 5 prime to 3 prime at the 3 prime to 5 prime stands. And we know that the one strand is continuous and another is discontinuous strands, that's called as the lagging strand, and the continuous strand is called as the leading strand. So that means the replication is a bidirectional process, not a unidirectional process. Then we discuss about the origin of replication. Dear friends, the origin is very important, very important part of the every process. As we know that, when we talk about the bacteria, the genome of the bacteria is very small, or the size of the genome is very small. So in the bacteria, the ORI, the number of ORI is near about a single. One ORI is present. Dear friends, but what exactly happens, what sequence is present in the ORI? It is very complicated sequence, but having the 80 rich sequence, near about 10 to 100 base pairs of the 80 is present in the ORI. But dear friends, why the 80 is present in this ORI? As we are aware that according to the Watson and Crick, the guanine and cytosine binds to each other by the 3 hydrogen bond, while the adenine and thymine binds to each other by only 2 hydrogen bond. So for the helicase activity, the helicase require the less energy to break the 80 bond as compared to the GC bond. So dear friends, the 80 rich sequence is present at the ORI region, or the restart point of the replication. Dear friends, when we talk about the eukaryotes or the multicellular organisms, they are complex organisms having the large genome size. So for the replication of this large genome size, we require to start at the multiple points. So for that, what happened in the eukaryotes, there is the multiple ORI is present and they are automatically operated. Hence, it is called as the ARS sequence, that is autonomous replicating sequence. The structure of the ORI is same to that of the prokaryotic ORI. Dear friends, then we discuss about the replication is a template dependent. We know that a strand of DNA molecules is used for the formation of new strand is called as the template strand. So without template strand, new strands could not be synthesized. DNA polymerase requires only 3 prime to 5 prime strand as the template strand. So the replication, for the replication, we require one template strand. Then we discuss about the replication is always takes place in 5 prime to 3 prime direction. Why it is so? We discuss in this figure. Suppose this is the one strand having the 3 prime to 5 prime. Here is the thymine, and as we know that we are constructing the new strand from this template strand. And we add the first adenine against the thymine. When we study the structure of this adenine, we found that at the 5 prime end, or the at the 5 carbon, there is the 3 phosphate. So that means what happened? At the 5 prime, there are 3 phosphates group are present. But when we talk about the 3 prime, or the third carbon of that particular sugar having the OH bond, that means the 3 prime or the 3 carbon end of that particular nucleotide is free to attach the new nucleotide. So what happened when we go for the addition of the another nucleotide? So what happened here? The hydrogen which is present at the 3 prime which lose its place, and the oxygen become more electronegative, and as we know that the oxygen is the electron hungry molecules, which gives a nucleophilic attack on the alpha phosphate. So due to the nucleophilic attack on the alpha phosphate, what happens? These two phosphate is released, that is gamma and delta phosphate is released from these three phosphate. So what happened that due to the releasing of the these two phosphate or the pyrophosphate, a very important bond is takes place in between the sugar and this phosphate is called as the phosphodiester bonds. As we know that when we break the phosphate bond, then the energy is released, and that energy is utilized for the process of replication. So dear friends, after the cleaving of the alpha phosphate, we release the two phosphate groups, and again that two phosphate group is called as the pyrophosphate. So again that pyrophosphate is cleaved by a very important enzyme that called as the pyrophosphatase, and due to this cleavage of this pyrophosphate, a 7.2 kilocalorie energy is released, and that energy is utilized for the process of replication or the carried out the forward reaction. Dear friends, so that's why we simply said that the replication is always takes place from its 5 prime to 3 prime direction, because 3 prime is always free to attach the upcoming nucleotides. Then we discuss about a very important part of the DNA replication, that is enzyme involved in the DNA replication. Dear friends, these are the role models of that the process of the DNA replication. So these are the some enzymes which plays a crucial or very important role in the process of DNA replication. Here are the some enzymes like helicase, topoisomerase, primase, RNA polymerase, ligase, nucleases, single standing binding proteins, RPA, RPAC, that proteins plays important role in the that particular process of DNA replication. As I said that these are the real heroes of the DNA replication cinema. They plays a very crucial role. So that's why we will see the what they carried out the different functions one by one. First we discuss about the comparative study. Here are the comparative chart of the enzymes present in the bacteria and the enzyme present in the prokaryotes and their function. As we know that the for the initiation of the replication, we require the unwind to that particular DNA, and that that activity is carried out by the enzyme DNA B when we talk about the bacteria. And when we talk about the eukaryote, the activity of the helicase is carried out by the different types of the protein that called as the MCM, that is mini chromosome maintenance protein 2-7. So here are these different enzymes like the single standard binding maintenance protein, that is SSB. Here are the RPA. We will see the what are the different functions in upcoming slides. Dear friends, then the binding clamp is there. Beta clamp, here are called as the PCNA ring. The polymerization activity is carried out by the DNA polymerase 3. Here are carried out by the delta and epsilon. So dear friends, we will discuss the very important enzyme that called as the helicase. Dear friends, the helicase is the hexameric protein having the 6 different subunits. So this is called as the hexameric. It plays important role to unwind the DNA by the breaking of hydrogen bonds. And for that purpose, he used the ATP as energy and NAD as the cofactor. Dear friends, here we see that when we go for the initiation, we must require to mail that particular DNA so as to convert the double stranded DNA into the single stranded DNA. And for that, the helicase play a very crucial role. So dear friends, as we know that this is the hexameric protein. So 6 different subunits are present in the that complex. So in eukaryote, it's called as the MCM 2-7. When we count that MCM 2-7, that is mini chromosome maintenance, that means it is attached to the small part of the chromosome. That's why it is called as the mini chromosome maintenance. So the unit are the from 2-7, that means these are the 6. And the function of the helicase is carried out by the DNA B when we talk about the prokaryotes. So the function of the helicase is like the zippers. When we go for the open the zippers, as like one part of the that particular zipper is get released, and we got the 2 different strands, and we found the helical structure, we found the fork like structure. So dear friends, sometime in CSIR NET ask the question, ask about the what is the function of helicase, so unwinding, and sometime they ask on the ATP or on the NADP. So dear friends, then we discuss about the topoisomerase. So dear friends, what happened exactly due to the helicase activity? As we know that the helicase is doing his work in forward direction. At the time, what happened that the negatively supercoiled DNA is become more positively supercoiled. As we know the concept of the linking number. So linking number is nothing but the twist plus re. So what happened here due to the supercoiling? The twist number is just increased, that means twist number is decreased, and due to the decrease of the twist number, what happened, the tension is increased in that particular forward DNA. So to compensate that tension, what happened? The number of read is increased. So due to that, what happened? The supercoiled DNA is now converted into the negatively supercoiled DNA. So what is the read? Read is nothing but, as we know, that the DNA is formed by the helical structure. The superhelical or the supercoil, the coilings of the coiling is called as the read. So due to the increased number of read, what happened? The tension of that particular DNA is released, and that the tension is released by a very important enzyme, the massager of the DNA, that called as the topoisomerase. Dear friends, when you talk about the eukaryotes called as the gyrase, there are two different types of the topoisomerase. There is top 1 and top 2. They play a very role to release the tension, that is, convert the positively supercoiled DNA into the negatively supercoiled DNA. Dear friends, the topoisomerase releases tension by giving a single stranded break. Dear friends, this has the ability to break and rejoin the strands. That means it has two activities, breaking and the rejoining of the DNA strands. So when you talk about the topoisomerase 2, which has which gives the double stranded break, and for that he used the 2 ATPase. Dear friends, suppose we are infected with the bacteria, doctor give us different antibiotics. But what exactly that the function of that antibiotics? Dear friends, some of the antibiotics having the norfloxacin, ciprofloxacin, nildaxic acid, which present in that particular antibiotic. And that antibiotic, the chemical present in the antibiotic, which inhibit the topoisomerase 2. And due to this activity, what happened? The replication process, which is not further carried out in the DNA in that particular bacteria. So what happened? Instead of stopping of the DNA replication, that bacteria, the bacterial load is increased there, decreased day by day, and finally we are cured. Dear friends, as we know that these are the massager of DNA, which release the tension of the DNA. So this is I just told you about that, how they release how they reduce the linking number, what is the read and what is the twist. For that we require more time to explain the. So another very important enzyme of the DNA replication is the primase, and which plays important role of the addition of the primer. So we'll talk about the addition of the primer in the DNA in that particular prokaryotes. It added by the DNA primase enzymes. But when we talk about the eukaryotes, the primer is added by the DNA polymerase alpha. Generally, the primase at near about 5 to 10 nucleotides long RNA primer required to start the replication. But when we talk about the eukaryotes, the DNA polymerase alpha at the 50 nucleotide RNA primer. And dear friends, as we know that due to the addition of the RNA primer, DNA polymerase got the free 3' OH group. And due to this free 3' OH group, that particular DNA polymerase continuously synthesize the new DNA strands. But when you talk about the lagging strands, we need to add the small patches of primer in a short interval. That is called as the Okazaki fragment. And in that fragment, what happened? We got a DNA-RNA fragment. That is the called as the Okazaki fragments. So on the lagging strand or on the leading strand, both strands require the addition of the primer, and the function of the addition of the primer was carried out by the DNA primase and DNA polymerase alpha and that particular enzymes. So the RNA primer is later erased by or the replaced with the DNA by a different enzymes. For example, that is DNA polymerase alpha in prokaryotes and DNA polymerase 1 in prokaryotes and DNA polymerase delta and epsilon in the eukaryotes. So this is about the primer. Then we discuss about the another very important the enzymes or the real hero of that particular the DNA DNA replication, that is DNA polymerase. It was firstly discovered by the Arthur Kornberg, as we discussed in first slides. So it is called as the Kornberg enzyme also. So there are different types of the Kornberg enzymes or the DNA polymerase was discovered by the Arthur. and he gives name as DNA polymerase 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 when you talk about deep prokaryotes. So DNA polymerase first has plays a crucial role having the three different activities, that is 5 prime to 3 prime polymerase activity, as well as the 3 prime to 5 prime procaridium activity, 5 prime to 3 prime exonuclease activity, and the main function is in the removal of primer, and the gap was filled by helping of the DNA polymerase called as the nick translation, which is used for the construction of the small probes. Then another very important protein is the DNA polymerase 2, which has the role in the DNA repair mechanism. Then DNA polymerase 3 has actually two activities, that is polymerase activity and the 3 prime to 5 prime proofreading activity. And here are the DNA polymerase 4 and 5, which plays an important role in the DNA repair, that is SOS repair system and the error prone repair system. This is about DNA polymerase present in the prokaryotes. Then we talk about the DNA polymerase present in the eukaryotes. As we know that the DNA polymerase of the eukaryotes having the multiple subunits ranging from alpha, beta, gamma, delta, epsilon, neta, iota, kappa. So these are the different type of the subunits present in this DNA polymerase and carry out the different functions. Here we see that DNA polymerase alpha play a crucial role in the polymerization and the primer addition. In the bacteria, the primer is added by the enzyme primase, but when we talk about the eukaryotes, the primer is added by the DNA polymerase alpha. Then we talk about the DNA polymerase beta, which plays a crucial role in the DNA repair system. Then DNA polymerase gamma role in the replication of mitochondrial DNA as well as the chloroplast DNA present in the animal cell or the plant cell. The chloroplast presently present in the plant cell. So DNA polymerase delta and epsilon plays a crucial role to polymerize the DNA because it is highly processive enzyme as compared to the DNA polymerase alpha, because it has a special enzyme that called as the PCNA rings, that called as the proliferative cell nuclear antigen ring, which gives them a high processivity, and due to which they are continuously adding the nucleotides on the DNA, on the template DNA. Dear friends, then the another very important enzyme is the DNA ligase. It is called as the molecular glue. What the DNA ligase is do? Here we see that the DNA ligase just ligate the two DNA strands by adding the phosphodiester bonds. But what is the exact procedure? How they add the how to join that particular DNA strand? For that, we need to understand this figure. Dear friends, these are the two DNA strands. Which is formed by the on the Okazaki fragments. Here we see that there is the nick present in between these two strands. I am saying the nick, not the gap. So gap is a gap and the nick is a different concept. In the gap, we add the nucleotides. We are able to add the nucleotides, but in the nick, we are unable. We could not add the nucleotides in the nick. So dear friends, in this nick, we see that there is the 5' phosphate group and the 3' OH group. But for the nucleophilic attack, three prime O require the one more phosphate, that is alpha phosphate, that phosphate bond. So for that, what happened? Helicase with the help of ATP add the one phosphate at this 5 prime end. Here we see that the three phosphate among that two phosphates, one phosphate is added at the 5 prime end of the one piece of that particular DNA, and the remaining two phosphate, that called as the pyrophosphate, are released from the ATPs, and that furthermore, cleaved by the pyrophosphatase, and the energy is utilized for the replication purpose, as we discussed in earlier. So, dear friends, here are the last nucleotide which attached with the that particular 2-phosphate. Now, that oxygen is become more electronegative, and it gives the nucleophilic attack on the alpha phosphate. And due to this activity, dear friends, what happened that the phosphodiester bond present between the alpha phosphate and this oxygen, and the one phosphate is released, that called as the AMP. So this is the function of the DNA ligase. Then we talk about the actual process. As we know that when we go for the any process, we require a very good initiation. The initiation part of the every process is very important, because this part is the rate limiting part which decide the fate of all the reaction. So dear friends, when we talk about the initiation of replication in eukaryotes, as we know that when the cell is undergo the cell division, they are going to the cell cycle. And as we know that the cell cycle ranging from the G0, G1, S phase, G2 phase and M phase. But dear friends, what happens when the cells undergoes in the G1 phase, they are unable to synthesize the DNA or to carry out the DNA replication. Why this is so? This is because there are some factor which is attached to the origin of replication that called as the ORC and the CDC6 and CDT1. At the late phase of the G1 phase, what happened? The two factors that called as the CDC6 and CDT1 along with the ORC encounter the ORI region. So due to this activity, what happened? The ORI region is encounter or busy with this factor. Dear friends, when we talk about the yeast, this ORC is in the multiple, that called as the complex having the different proteins or different enzymes. When we talk about the yeast having the six different type of the ORCs, that is ORC1, ORC2, ORC3, 4 and 5 and 6. So that means ORC is nothing but the complex, and that complex is associated with a very two important proteins of the G1 phase that called as the cell cycle division protein C, that is 6 and CDT1. And there are some other proteins also associated with this complex. So this complex all together are called as the pre-initiation complex. So dear friends, in G1 phase, that pre-initiation complex is in inactive phase. So due to that, what happened? The replication is not initiated in G1 phase. But what happened when that cell is undergo or the transport from G1 phase to the S phase? What happened that the S phase CDKs and DDKs add the phosphate on the CDC6 and CDT1. So dear friends, the S phase CDKs are the kinases, as we know that the kinases are the enzymes which add the phosphate group. And due to the addition of the phosphate group, what happened? The molecular changes has been carried out in that particular protein or that particular enzyme. Dear friends, the same molecular changes takes place in the protein associated with the ORI region. So CDKs and DDKs not only add on the phosphate group on the CDC6 and CDT1, they add the every proteins which is associated with this ORI region. And due to the addition of that particular CDK and DDK, the molecular conformation has takes place in that particular enzyme. And due to what happened, the CDC6 and CDT1 along with ORC released from the ORI region. Now friends, what happened? The ORI is now free to bind with the helicase and to do the function of the helicase. But you might have question, what exactly happened? What is the molecular conformational change? And for that we discuss here the in this particular small video. Suppose this is the active site of the enzymes where the phosphate group is added. This is the active site, and due to the addition of the phosphate group, what happened that the active site, the structure of the active site become changed, and now it is no longer attached to that the substrate. So that means what happened? Due to change in the active site, the proteins could not bind to that particular ORI region and they release from that region. So due to this activity of what happened, the helicase is combined, helicase is binds with or recruited with the ORI region with the another two protein that called as the CDC45 and the GIN protein. So this is the complex. Not only helicase plays a role in the unwinding of DNA, helicase requires the CDC45 enzyme and the GIN enzyme. This whole complex plays a very vital role to melt the DNA or to unwind the DNA. So dear friends, what happened due to this activity? The melting of DNA takes place, and we found the DNA replication 4 or the replication bubble here. And due to this activity, we found that the helicase is undergoing in the forward direction. And we got the two different strands of the DNA, that is 3 prime and 5 prime. And here we got the 5 prime and the 3 prime. But is it possible? It is possible to rejoin that particular two strands. Okay, but it's not happened. We have a very important enzyme that called as the single stranded binding protein or RPA protein, which is play important role to inhibit the rewinding of that particular DNA strands, which maintain the unwinding of that particular DNA strand. So dear friends, what happened in the initiation? The initiation complex is formed, which having the DNA polymerase alpha, which add the primer, that is the RNA primer having the 50 nucleotide long, when we talk about the replication initiation in the eukaryotes. So due to this activity, what happened? The primosome is formed, and which contain the helicase along with CDC45UGI. Dear friends, when the particular cells successfully initiate the replication, then that cell undergoes in the elongation process. So in this elongation process, what happened that the primosome which is formed in the initiation is get converted into the replicosome. So what happened that the one enzyme is replaced in the replicosome, and that enzyme is called as the DNA polymerase alpha. So alpha is replaced by the another two subunits that is called as the delta and epsilon. So after addition of the primer, DNA polymerase alpha is removed from that particular template DNA, and DNA polymerase delta and epsilon is recruited here. So why we recruit the DNA polymerase alpha, delta and epsilon instead of the alpha? Because the alpha has the no pcna rings, and due to that it is not the processive enzyme, and DNA polymerase delta or epsilon has the pcna ring, that is proliferative cell nuclear antigen ring, and due to this both enzymes are the highly processive enzymes. So dear friends, due to its high processivity, it could not slip from the DNA template strands, and it continuously synthesizes the DNA. So dear friends, for the addition of the DNA pcna rings on the DNA polymerase, the RPC, that is replication protein C, plays very vital role. With the help of ATP, it adds the pcna rings on the DNA polymerase delta and epsilon, and due to this activity, they both are become the highly processive enzymes and continuously synthesizes the DNA. Dear friends, when we talk about these strands, that is the 3 prime to 5 prime, we got the free 3 prime OH group, and that's why DNA polymerase delta and epsilon continuously synthesizes the strands as the forward direction. But when we talk about this strand, that is the 5 prime to 3 prime strands, suppose we add the primer here, then we got the 3 prime OH here. That is not possible. We got the 3 prime OH here, and here is the 5 prime ends. So that is not possible for DNA polymerase to continue the polymerization in this direction. So for that, we need to add the primer in this direction, that is opposite direction. So we add that particular enzymes, add the primer in this direction, and we got the 3 prime end here. Okay, and after the addition of the primer, what happened? DNA polymerase delta and epsilon continuously synthesizes the DNA. But what happened after that? We need to add another primer. So what happened here that in this strand we got the small patches of RNA, DNA, RNA, DNA. That's why this strand is called as the lagging strand, and this strand is called as the leading strand, because this strand is continuously synthesis. We will see in this next slide what exactly happened. So this is about the helicase which unwind the DNA. Here we are talking about the 5 prime to 3 prime end, and we need to add the primer here. So here is the 3 prime end, and that DNA polymerase add the new nucleotide, that is DNA nucleotide, in this direction. And dear friends, we got the small patches of the RNA and DNA, RNA and DNA, that patches is called as the Okazaki fragment. That was firstly discovered by the Reiji Okazaki, and for that he got the Nobel Prize. Dear friends, when we talk about the Okazaki fragments in prokaryotes, the number or the size of the Okazaki fragment is very short. It is near about 100 nucleotide long. But when we talk about the Okazaki fragments in the eukaryotes, the size is comparatively longer. It is ranging from 100 nucleotides to the 1000 nucleotides. Dear friends, as we see here,
This stand is continuously synthesis as the forward direction, and this strand, particularly from 5 prime to 3 prime, is not continuously synthesis because we got the free 3 prime OH end in this direction. So this strand is not continuous. This is called as a discontinuous replication. It takes place in this line. So the discontinuous replication is takes place on those strand that called as the lagging strands, and the replication is continuous in strand that strand is called as the leading strand. So this is about the process of elongation. Then we discuss about, as we know that due to the Okazaki fragments, the RNA is inserted in that particular DNA strands. But as we already aware that in our genome there is no RNA in the DNA. So what happened here, that RNA primer is removed by two important protein that called as the RNAs and flap endonuclease. Dear friend, these are the nucleases. As we know that the nucleases are the enzymes which cleaves the nucleic acid or which degrade the nucleic acid. So dear friends, as we are going to talk on first enzyme that called as the RNase H1, that RNase H1 is cut the DNA at the one terminal of that particular RNA primer and you start to remove one nucleotide by one nucleotide. But for the RNase H1, it's not possible to break the last bond which is present between the last nucleotide of RNA and the first nucleotide of the DNA. So due to that, we require another enzyme that called as the FE1 endonuclease or the flap endonuclease. Dear friends, it is called as the endonuclease, but it's not the endonuclease, it is the exonuclease, because it cut the DNA at the terminal end, not from the middle end. When the nucleic acid or the nucleases cut the particular nucleic acid from the middle edge, from the center, then it is called as the endonuclease. And when the nuclease cut the nucleic acid from the terminal end, it is called as the exonuclease. So dear friend, this is the misnomenclature of this enzyme, that is flap endonuclease. It is the actual exonuclease. So dear friends, due to the action of RNase H1 and the flap endonuclease 1, these RNA patches are removed from that particular lagging strands and leading the formation of the small gap in that lagging strand. And dear friends, that small gap is filled by the DNA polymerase delta and epsilon. So they fill the gap but do not join these two DNA strands to each other. So for that purpose, we require the another enzyme that called as the molecular glue. So what happened that due to the filling of gap, there is the presence of nick here. And as we know that there is difference between the gap and the nick. So what happened in the gap, we should add the nucleotides here. But when we talk about the nick, we are not able to add the nucleotide in that particular nick region. So this is the differentiation of gap and nick. So dear friends, that nick is sealed by the molecular glue that called as the DNA ligase. So DNA ligase add the phosphodiester bond in between the 5 prime phosphate and the 3 prime O, and due to that activity, the nick sealing has been takes place by the DNA ligase enzyme. So this is about the elongation of the DNA replication. It is continuously when the two replication fork is unite or the encounter to each others. So this is about the elongation of the DNA replication. Then we discuss about the topoisomerase activity in upcoming lectures. Then we discuss about the termination, how the termination of the replication is takes place. Dear friends, it's not possible, it is not easy to terminate the replication. The termination of replication occurs by the meeting of two replication fork at the termination zone. When the two replication fork encounter each other, the termination of replication takes place. It is easy to say that the
when the two replication fork is unite and the termination is takes place. Dear friends, but actually it is not a very simple phenomenon. For that require various important proteins to terminate their replication. Here are we see that these are the two different replication forks are there, and now they are come in front of each other. And here we see that these are the helicase. As I told you that not only helicase is present on here, helicase with the MCM, helicase that called as MCM227 along with the CDC45 and GIN proteins which present at that particular stand. Dear friends, what happened that when that two MCM encounters to each other, the SCF E3, that is ubiquitin ligase, this enzyme is recruited on the MCM227. This is the ubiquitin ligase which add the ubiquitin on the MCM7 subunit, not add all the phosphate on the ubiquitin on the all subunit of that particular MCM227. It add the ubiquitin on the only 7 subunit, that called as the polyubiquitinization. So dear friends, what happened here, due to the addition of the ubiquitin, that called as the polyubiquitinization, when any ubiquitin ligase add the ubiquitin on that particular proteins, the proteins are sent to the proteasomes for the degradation. But dear friends, here this is not happen because the one protein which protect the MCM7 from the degradation, that called as the P97 protein, is called as the protein remodular, which protect the MCM7 for the degradation in the proteasome. So what they do? They do just they remove the ubiquitins from the MCM7 and cause the disassembly of active helicase. When they remove the ubiquitin from that particular helicase, the helicase associated with the other proteins that called as the CDC45, that MCM227, and the gene protein that called as the CMG complex. That CMG complex is dissociated. When that CMG complex, that is CDC45, mini chromosome maintenance protein, and the gene protein is dissociated, then what happened that the termination of that particular replication is takes place. So ubiquitin ligase is very important protein to remove or to terminate the replication process. So dear friend, this is about overall process of replication in eukaryotes. So there is no remarkable difference between the process of replication in eukaryotes and the prokaryotes. So these are the as we see here, the when two fork is unite, the replication is terminated. So dear friend, this is about the summary that how the replication is takes place. Thank you. These are the references I used to prepare this today's lecture. Thank you so much, and best of luck for your CSIR NET exam. Thank you.